Hey, Jeff Justice here with Jeff Justice Seminars for Court Reporters. I want to thank you so much for deciding to choose us to get your online CEUs with. We promise not to disappoint you. We provide laugh-packed, content-rich seminars so that you can get your CEUs from the comfort of your own home or office. So basically, you're going to watch the videos as you do, print out the PDFs for the quizzes, answer the questions as you go along. At the end of the whole seminar, so if you're taking a 10-hour seminar, after you finish all the sections, email me all of your answers. I will grade them and get you back your letter of completion for your state, and if you're an RPR, the proper forms for NCRA. So get ready to laugh and learn with Jeff Justice Seminars for Court Reporters. Okay, a nice round of applause for Anita Paul Johnston with How to Educate Attorneys.
Hello.
Hello.
No, you are not expected to open a law school. Educating attorneys, unfortunately, is fairly low on the totem pole in law school. They do have a lot to cover, and I'm not going to discuss that in great detail. It's such a huge topic. But of course, from our perspective, we're going to talk about things. Perhaps you might not have thought of these things in the past, or maybe you have, okay? So let's take a look at our handout on how to educate attorneys. Again, if you have any questions, we welcome your questions, we encourage your questions, and when you give a question to the group, I'll guarantee you there are other people in the room thinking the exact same thing. And you are helping the quality of this seminar. So participating, answers, questions, thoughts, ideas, it's all extremely welcome. Good? By the way, we already have a prize for Starla because she contributed so much in our first session. So thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's take a look at page one. The attorney and court reporter have aligned same goals, or do they? You would think we're all on the same page, wouldn't you? I'm going to read some of this because the nature of this particular seminar, in my opinion, lent itself well to some sentences for you to walk away with. That's why there's a little bit more verbiage in this one handout than the other. The others. Okay. Usually everyone wants a clean, accurate record that, if necessary, will be upheld on appeal. Then there is the so-called strategic or intimidating, the tricky attorney who purposely obstructs the record for various reasons. Do they want to intimidate the witness and create such chaos, animosity, unpleasantness, and discord so that the witness will be so miserable they won't want to testify in court? The witness goes to the depot, has such a horrible experience, turns to the attorney and says, I'm not going to court. I'm not going to testify. Why? We know why. When an attorney is put on notice that the record is suffering, some attorneys simply don't care. Others do. When we say, if you talk on top of each other, your record is suffering, I would say most attorneys don't care. Believe it or not, you might think, wow, Anita, that's a lot, most. Well, I'm telling you my experience. You are so well trained to get every word, it's impossible to get every word if you do not hear clearly. It is impossible to get every word if they speak too fast. It is impossible for you to get every word if they do not comprehend what is being said. And it is impossible to get every word when several people are speaking at the same time. Do court reporters get upset? Here is where number one is vital. By the way, the answer to that question is, do court reporters get upset? What's the answer, folks? Yes, that's right. So tell me, I guess you allow yourself to get upset because something is happening, right? How smart is that? We're going to talk about that. And I will give you a good book on that one. Okay? All right. Number one, your self-esteem, your self-confidence, and your emotional well-being are absolutely first and vital. Everything flows from that. When you are intact, this is the core. This is the origination of your daily, hourly, weekly experience. You do not anyone allow to interfere with that. Isn't that what we do with our relatives, the people we work with? Anyone who can be abusive? You set boundaries and you take care of yourself. How many of you feel you have good boundaries set in parts of your life? Good, good. So your relatives have boundaries. They can't call you 7 times a day. They can't stop you from what you're doing and make you go run an errand. Do you have boundaries on when you do have time for them and when you don't? I hope so. You set boundaries and take care of yourself first. This does not mean that you do not give exceptional customer service, and it doesn't mean that you don't care. Of course you care, and you do give great service. It does mean, however, that you develop strategies to handle difficult situations with other people that you have no control over, but you do have control over your own responses and how you show up. You have control over you. That is all you can control. So whatever goes on in the outside world goes on in the outside world. It doesn't mean that you can control that. Are y'all with me on that? Yeah. One of my most favorite quotes from Eleanor Roosevelt. No one can make you feel inferior without your consent. No one can make me feel embarrassed without my consent. No one can make me feel intimidated without my consent. And you could add to that infinitum. Because you do have choices. You have control over you. There are many nice ways you can phrase something. Somebody, give me a situation where it's very difficult for you because whoever, it's either who the person is, what the topic is, or whatever it is. Somebody.
Your mom.
Your mom. Who said that? Thank you. Absolutely. What if it's your mom? Can you give me an idea what some moms, doesn't have to be you and personal, but what do some moms do that make life a little uncomfortable?
Nag.
I heard the word mad. Does that mean moms?
Nag.
Oh, mad. Oh, yeah, now we're talking about moms. See, they know better than we do. We're adults. Excuse me, Mom. Did you know that I'm not 4 years old anymore? Did anybody tell you? I'm just kidding. Okay, so nagging. You bet. What else?
Make you feel guilty.
Make you feel guilty. What did she just say? Anybody, what did she just say?
Make you.
Make you. And what does that say at the bottom of page one?
No one can make you.
No one can make you feel inferior. Now we got a new one. No one can make you feel guilty without your consent. Thank you, Mom. I have a reject button here, and I choose to reject the word guilty So, you are now rejected. I'm just playing with you. Okay, anything else that comes to mind? Let's talk about Matt. No, who was it? Nad. I keep having Nad in my head. Nad. Moms can nad. Yes.
I think, well, in my case, I don't think that they really understand what it is that we do and why we don't have all the time in the world to answer their calls at any given time and, you know, maybe visit more often. And and I did used to feel guilt, you know, with things like that. But I have just learned as I've gotten older that no is a complete sentence. So,
okay.
No, period. That's, and I don't
Excellent.
Do a lot of things that I just don't want to do anymore. My time is very valuable to me.
So let me repeat. Moms and people in general cannot begin to understand what we do. We don't have time to visit. We don't have time for phone calls. We don't have time for a party. We don't have time for different things. It's our lives, and they can't understand. And you don't get upset anymore. You simply say no. And they're learning to trust your words, even though they don't like them, right? And that can be a very difficult situation. Does anyone else experience that with either friends or moms or any close people in your life? No?
Yes.
None of you are that busy? This is an unbusy group. Okay. Thank you. Excellent idea. So, let's talk about that for just a moment. What can we say? What is our languaging to, since we're on the topic of moms, we'll just say moms, but it could be a friend or a spouse or anyone else. You love me so much that you want to be with me. You love me so much that you enjoy talking to me. And I want to tell you something. I feel exactly the same way. And I love you a lot. And I want to have fun with you. And I want to have all this great communication time with you. My job, I have discovered the hard way, prevents me from doing the kind of life I would love. Mom, I think you could probably compare me to somebody who's studying for the bar exam. When you're studying for the bar exam, you don't go to the wedding, you don't go to the party, you don't go to the family dinner. There are a lot of things you don't do when you've got another 5 hours of study. And that is very important. And yes, that's for a given period of time, a short time. I just want you to know that my heart and soul is with you. Because I have such time constraints, and I do need to limit my time with you, it's not out of choice and joy. It's out of doing my job as an excellent court reporter. I'm not the only one. And I just want you to know I appreciate you. And I'm happy that you want to be with me. And I would love to be with you. I must plan my time and accomplish what I must accomplish in order to be a successful court reporter. I'm not asking you to understand it. I'm asking you to accept it. And when we are together, it is extra special to me. I don't know, would something like that work? I'm going to give you a few examples on how to talk to people. The more inclusive you are, the more thoughtful you are of their position. Mom, you don't understand. I've got 837 pages to get out. I'm on an expedite. I've got this 0-4 coming up. I am blah, 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 I. They're not going to understand you any more than you want to understand their medical problems. And yes, they've got this new symptom. They might have to have a surgery, and this is going on, and that. Oh my God, they said I might have to have a colostomy. You know what that means? TMI. Do you understand what I'm saying? All you want is their caring, their loving, and to know that you care about them and you love them. Let's make a time. Every Saturday for 15 minutes, we can have a phone conversation. It's not ideal, but it's something. It's what I can do. It's what I would love to do with you. And we'll see as our days and weeks evolve. But to control your time. Does that make sense? Might that work? You certainly give it a try. How's that? I'm not saying it'll work. I'm not saying it's perfect. For some people, these ideas have worked. Okay, good? Any other thought? Okay, Nag, exactly the same thing. Mom, the things you, let's watch our words, please. You go to work, watch out for Mabel. She's a backstabber. Oh, George is a social climber. He'll say anything. He'll take credit for anything to get a raise or a higher position. He lies about the real time so he can get those big jobs, even though he's not that good. Let's watch lies, social climber, all the adjectives we put on people. Do you know that there are places in the corporate world where there is no gossip allowed? There is no boiler, no water cooler talk allowed? Water cooler talk, gossip, is horrible. And when you put a label on somebody, they've got this image. They got it. Backstabber. Gotta watch my back. Really? Or is that person hurting and had a bad experience and what they did was perceived as backstabbing? If there's somebody you don't like, somebody who's been spoken to negatively, have you ever thought of going to lunch with that person? How about let's go to lunch one day and get to know each other a little better? My treat. Talk to a person, get to know them. Get to know their heart. You might be amazed. Now, having said that, we're talking about the nag. Is Mom really nagging? Mom, the way you talk to me shows that you care about me and worry about me. You only want what's best for me, and you always have. Do you know how lucky I am to have such a wonderful mother? You're always there when I need you, and you bring so much joy to me. Now, where did you hear in that the word nag? Do you understand what I'm saying? You can address something that would bother you. You could say, once you've acknowledged them, you see, I love the word acknowledge, and I use that in all of my classes, including my exceptional customer service classes when you get irate customers. People want to be acknowledged. People want to be respected. People want to be heard. So when you talk to Mom, don't use the word nag. That's just an adjective that you've chosen. I'm not saying it's not true. I'm just saying you don't need that word. You could use a word like caring, loving. Sometimes, Mom, when you are giving me advice, I just want you to know I really appreciate it. And sometimes I need to fly my own wings, come up with my own solutions and results, and love you dearly for caring. And a little tiny bit less of all the advice and the things that are going on, I might be able to learn from that, grow from that, and appreciate it. But I want you to know you are one heck of a mother. Would that work? Because her mom has done a lot for her. So, but that's not the point. The point is, what is our verbiage? How do we talk to people? How are we supportive of other people? Okay? Is there anybody else that comes to mind on this topic? Yes?
Maybe the person that sets the book and you are trying to control your schedule but decline that you are not able to in a nice way and then not have guilt feelings.
Oh, beautiful. So they're setting the calendar. They want you to work on blah, blah day. You very politely decline because you're not available that day. And you need to avoid the guilt feelings. I don't know what kind of a relationship you have with I was going to say the bookkeeper, and I was going to say the beekeeper. No. I don't know what kind of a relationship you have with that person, but a simple conversation, I want you to know I am available 3 days a week, more if possible, and my goal is to make your life as easy as possible. You have a huge job. You want to fill your books. I want to do everything I can to assist. And yes, there will be up to 2 days a week when I will not be available. Let me know. Let me see what I can do. I will do everything I can for you. And I am so appreciative that you will respect my pace when I do have to say no. Are you okay with that? Is there something else you would like me to do? Do you understand? You're setting the boundaries early. Now, who heard in that the word guilt? I'll tell you where the word guilt is. I vote for guilt. Oh, where's the guilt? Come on, guilt. Are you Catholic? Good guilt. Are you Jewish? Good guilt. Do you understand what I'm saying? I'm Jewish by birth. Not a religious person by any organized religion. When I was 22 years old, I heard audio series, cassette series. Now, a cassette's a little round thing, a little rectangle thing, had a little tape in it. See, they wouldn't know what a cassette is. We know. Okay. It's called Lead the Field by Earl Nightingale. I don't know if it's digitized. I don't know if it's on DVD or CD. If you can find it, I think it's wonderful. A lot of great stories. Stories like Acres of Diamonds. Have you ever heard that story? Acres of Diamonds. Oh, cute story. Anyway, I listened to it when I was 22 years old. And I'll never forget, Earl Nightingale said, people worry 92% of the time, unnecessarily. When I heard that, I said to myself, I am not going to worry again. Why should I, if it's unnecessary 92%? And what sounds important, why should I worry? Because what if it doesn't happen? And then what if it does happen? What kind of a quality is worry? Why do you need to do that to yourself? How are you going to have a happy day at the end of the day if you're full of worry? For whatever it's worth to you. Make sense? Okay. So, I hope that helps with your thought of worry. Okay. Number two, how to interrupt effectively. Don't say, I'm sorry. Don't apologize because they are not speaking appropriately for the record. Why should you apologize? I know some of this is repetitive. Some people like to hear it more than once. And by the way, people have come to my exact same workshops 3, 4, 5 times. Las Vegas last month, we had our last live workshop. One young lady, Florinda, she was in there for her 6th time. And what they do is they come and they say, oh, I just learned something new. And I get such a kick out of it because I teach what I teach, real time. And it's hands-on and I'm teaching away and I teach them a concept. Ooh, that's kind of a good idea. Let me put that in my dictionary. Well, I call it a database. You're not a bad person if information is not in your database. Are you a bad person if information is in your not in your dictionary? Okay. So we're putting information in, and a court reporter says, oh, it's already in there. Well, of course it's already in there. You've heard it for 3 times. You never adopted it. You never chose to master it, which is fine. You know, I have to give a lot of information. I want people to walk away with value. If they already knew everything I gave them the first time, Where's my repeat customer? No, I didn't say that. No, but seriously, where is their learning? I give so much that they only learn a little bit each time. And John Harmonson, God love him, first workshop, he was so nervous, and he learned a little tiny bit, and he didn't grasp most of it, and he couldn't figure this out. That was too hard. Second time. Oh, it was already in there, right? Hey, maybe I will try this. The rest, too hard. Couldn't do it. The third, getting a little more familiar. And he kept coming back. John Harmonson was a regular freelance court reporter. He allows me to tell you how much money he made 2 years ago. Are you ready? As a freelance court reporter who has reported real time in 6 continents, by the way, he says, if you ever get a job in Antarctica, call him. He'll do it for free. John Harmonson has earned, as a freelance court reporter, over $300,000 a year. Do you think that effort was worth it? He ended up loving real time. His editing time was slashed by 70%. He became so acclimated and tuned in and enjoyed it. So, what's wrong with this picture? Yeah, I'm making $34,000 a year. I can't do real time. I make mistakes. And on and on. Let's talk about mistakes for just a minute. Did you know that everybody drops? I mean everybody. Ed Varallo, Marilyn Sanchez, Dee Baino, Melanie Humphrey-Sontag. What's his name? Mark Kisslinger. Do you know he drops? No. Mark is perfect. No, he's not. He knows I tell this. He has no problem with that. He's such a lovely young man. And he's not ego-driven. He is just a lovely, lovely young man. And he is human. I simply say to you, when you drop, you're in the very best of company. Okay, I'm going to move on. So, don't say I'm sorry when you interrupt. Don't apologize because they are not speaking for the record. You can interrupt and say, excuse me. Okay. Interrupt when necessary, but not too often. Well, Anita, sometimes it's often. You don't understand. If they are abusive all the time, screaming and yelling, they refuse to stop. Really, my friend Sylvia, she and her partner, Julie, opened an agency in 1976. They had writers in those days, but they had something very special. They had Scopus with IBM Selectric 2 typewriters. Now, a typewriter is a heavy thing that looks like a computer and you go like that. That's what a typewriter is. So they brought their 2 Scopists, their proofreaders, and their writers to this daily. Very important daily. And Julie took the first take. She went in and recorded on a nice manual machine. Then she goes in and dictates the notes and the typist. Well, they're Scopists. You have to be fancy. You can't call them a typist. You gotta be Scopists. Now, transcriptionists. Okay. So they go in, and Julie's supposed to type her first 20 minutes, hand it to the transcriptionist or the Scopist, and they process the work. 20 minutes into the deposition, Julie comes flying out of the room in tears, runs to the bathroom, hysterical. Sylvia, being a good friend, says, Julie, what happened? What's the matter? And Julie said, they were horrible. They were so horrible. First, they started screaming at each other and really being belligerent. Then they started in on the witness, and they were so horrible to the witness. And then they started in on me, and they asked me to read back. I read back, and I know I did a good job. And they said I was wrong. And they were telling me that I wasn't a very good court reporter. She was devastated. Sylvia, being a good friend, walked back into the room after the break, sat down, and continued the deposition. Okay? So, there she is, continuing the deposition. Before you know it, the attorneys start yelling at each other and belittling each other and whatever. Then they started on the witness, and then Sylvia. Mistake. You don't mess with Sylvia. And when you hear Pam later today, it would be like messing with Pam. So Sylvia is listening to this and watching them. And Sylvia did something interesting. Sylvia stood up and said, "Counsel, you will either grow up, behave yourself, conduct yourself as a professional, or I'm out of here." And the attorney looked at Sylvia and said, "You can't leave." And Sylvia said, "Oh, really, counsel?" She was that kind of a person. She would have been a great teenager with the whatever that time. So she walks over to her desk, picks up the telephone. She says, "I'm just going to call the judge and get a ruling." The attorney said, "You can put the phone down. You can sit down. Excuse me." And an amazing thing happened. The attorneys grew up, behaved themselves, became professional, and the deposition ended. Sylvia told me the story one day, just because we chat all the time, she's a best friend. I said, "Sylvia, how did you know what to say? How did you know what to do?" She said, "I don't know. I just know my job." Do you know your job? Would Sylvia tolerate this behavior? No. What are they going to do to her? Put her in jail? No. About 8, 9 years later, Sylvia's taking a hearing around a banquet table. 9 attorneys around the table. They all give Sylvia her card and their client. We all know that, see each other, right? Sylvia gives them all her card. One of the attorneys picks up the card and says, "Are you Sylvia Masella? Are you Sylvia Masella?" And Sylvia says, "Well, yeah, why?" "Well, 9 years ago you took a job. You probably don't remember it like she'd ever forget." The attorneys were all being obstreperous, and the senior attorney of the questioning attorney directed that attorney to do anything and everything to obstruct the proceedings, to prevent that witness from showing up in court to testify, pull out all stops. You are the only court reporter who never allowed it. We talked about you for months. Folks, she simply would not allow inappropriate behavior. To Sylvia, this is a no-brainer. What's your problem? Of course you're not going to talk that way in a deposition. It was a setup. Court reporters don't realize that. You take everything so personally. Golly whiz, I wish you wouldn't do that. Look at the situation. Be professional yourself. Now, I didn't get to Sylvia. She didn't end up in tears. By the way, Sylvia has since retired. She was 50 years old when she retired. sold her business, and has been living in a beautiful dream home in Maui ever since. Okay, she's had some setbacks in life, as we all do. It sounds like paradise, perfect, everything, but she has had some horrible situations and, of course, wonderful, wonderful living. That's the story of Sylvia. So I say to you, please, be aware and look what we are never, never taught. It is terrible. It is an atrocity. Look how many court reporters out there end up very upset for no reason. They take it upon themselves.
Okay.
Yes.
What about the attorney that was actually making the witness mad? What did he have to say about the court reporter? Because he's the one that's going to call the firm and complain, and you're finally going to hear
it. Oh, give me a break.
I'm sorry.
I love you dearly. Did you hear her words? Listen to her words, because we all say this. He is the one who is going to complain. Where is that as a fact?
Because I ran across it.
Oh, she's run across. Do you know the guy we're talking about?
It's been so long. But
okay, excuse me. You have not run across him, okay? And you've run across some attorneys who have called and complained. And I wonder if the scenario was identical or possibly a little different. I'm not going to go there because we don't know. But he's going to complain. He's going to get her in trouble. If an agency sent her to that, or him, to that particular job, the agency's going to get mad at that court reporter. That agency might fire that court reporter. If it's a court administrator, the court administrator's going to get a complaint, and now they're going to get reprimanded for bad behavior. Excuse me, this is pure crap. What is more important? Some idiotic agency owner who wants the you-know-what to every single attorney and doesn't care about you? Or the same with the court administrator and they're losing a fabulous court reporter? Oh, please, do that to me. Call on me. Please, let them know what a horrible court reporter they have. I say, honey, I am going to the beach and I'm going to eat buttered popcorn. Bye. You let go of anything that doesn't work in your life. That is pure crap. I'm not trying to insult you.
Oh, no.
I understand people call and complain. I don't know what they call and complain about. I'm not saying that they're legitimate. Sometimes they are. Sometimes us court reporters don't behave properly. Sometimes we need to hear it. Other times we are great. We are doing our job. We are doing a great job. And we get reprimanded. So I'm not going to talk about an individual situation. I'll tell you one thing. I refused and never, would never, never, never work for an agency who does not treat their court reporters right. Do they treat their attorneys right? Of course. Do they go out of their way for their attorneys? Of course. I'm not saying we should be prima donnas. What I am saying is there's got to be justice. Hey, justice. There's got to be a balance. I would never tolerate inappropriate behavior. And I say to you, would you? Sylvia interpreted that for her as inappropriate behavior. So she has zero, zero fear of repercussions. Follow what I'm saying? Good. But I get upset when court reporters tell me that they're afraid of their agency owner. They can't afford to lose a job. I realize some of you might be in a very small area. There might be only one deposition firm to deal with. It might be pretty bad. They might not treat you right. They might think they've got you over a string. Well, guess what? Welcome, captioning. Heart, streaming, real time. Who has a hold over us? Do you see what I'm saying? We get to own our own lives. We get to own our own experiences. And you don't ever, I've already talked in the first session about emotional abuse or how we feel, and these are very important things with the things we're dealing with. So I hope that clarifies a little bit of at least my attitude. I'm not necessarily right. If you disagree, it's great. Love it. I want everybody to hear it. Okay, so interrupt when necessary, but not too often. That's why I put a limit of 3. I've heard some court reporters, well, I'll interrupt till I have to. I mean, if I can't hear, what did you say? Would you speak up? I can't hear? Can you repeat that? I need it louder? And on and on and on and on. People don't like to be interrupted. They're in a train of thought. It is unpleasant to be interrupted often. That's why I limit my interruptions to 3. That does not include the odd interruption for the, excuse me, what did you say? What was that name? When you're getting a quick clarification, that's fine. I'm talking about when I have to do it 3 times. I'm not going to interrupt anymore. An attorney, hello? Yeah, this court reporter interrupted all day long. Please don't send him back. Or don't send him back. I think that's legitimate. That's just me. I like to watch it. I like to be sensitive to what they are doing in their presentation and transcript. So that's why I say don't interrupt too often. Otherwise, you can very easily become obnoxious. I do not consider what Sylvia did obnoxious. You see, there are times when they can call and complain about you, but I don't know what for. So, whatever the circumstances are, we need to know the facts. Okay. All right. If I sound persnickety and over-detailed, it's because I'm also a certified life coach. I call people on their words. I call people on their body language. For example, poor Pam. We're chatting, having a nice visit. And she's so sweet, wonderful friend to me. And she'll say I'll say something to her. And she kind of does, kind of rolls her eyes. I say, I notice you're rolling your eyes. Is what I'm saying not right? And then she has to explain, why did she roll her eyes? I wanted to do that under the radar. I didn't want her to notice. Well, we do notice. And it's okay to call people on their body language. She knows I love her.
I have one more question. What happens in that scenario if she doesn't get the judge and she just walks out? What do you feel about that?
What happens if she doesn't get the judge and she ends up walking out? I'd make a record. I would say, based on the behavior of Mr. Smith and Mr. Jones and the dialogue of whatever, this deposition is now ended. I am ending it. I'd probably say something like that. Folks, it's not my words. Use your common sense. If you feel a deposition must be ended, end it. Has anybody ever ended a deposition before? Okay. There. I rest my case.
It needed to be interpreted. I just asked to go off the record and say, I can't understand. You know,
good.
I can't take the attorney's deposition. He was answering for his client.
Good. So it was inquiring about an interpreter. That's why she ended a deposition. Use your common sense. You used your common sense perfectly. Sounds good to me. Okay, Brenda? You get gold star. You keep this up, you might get a prize too. Yay. So, do attorneys educate their witnesses, their clients, their paralegals? Do they know to educate them? Explain, for example, it's not only real time, but if you're in a real time environment, you want to explain to anyone viewing the real time that this is an unedited, unproofread, rough draft. I like to say you will be able to read over 90% of what is being said. How many of you don't write 90%? You write between 90 and 100. I'll bet you every hand would go up if I said, do you all write at least 95%? But I'm not going to go there. All I'm saying to you is, how does it feel if your standard of output needs to be at least 90%? How does that make you feel? Say great. How does that make you feel?
Great.
Okay. So do you see what I'm saying? You give yourself that level. What is 90%? In the academic world, it's an A. And an A is good. So now you're giving them an expectation of a nice, readable, pretty good readable transcription on the real time. Lower your minimum. Just like when you said, I'm available 3 days a week. I will do my best to accommodate you anytime I can. You really can work 4 days a week, but you want to say 3 days a week. Do you understand what I'm saying? You want to under-promise, over-deliver. That's all. Now you're giving yourself a vid. You're giving yourself that room of comfort. Good?
Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Sure. So, people don't like to be right. I've already talked about that. Use tact in interrupting. We've already talked about that. Talked about it to death, I think. When someone speaks too fast, they mumble. Oh, when someone speaks too fast, they mumble. Speak too softly, speak on top of each other. Do you feel bad? Why? How about no longer? Doesn't make you feel bad. You are doing nothing wrong, handle it, take care of yourself. I hope you're getting some nice strategies here to handle that. All right. Do attorneys educate their witnesses, clients, paralegal? Explaining they can read over 90%, and it's a privilege to read real time. If that privilege is abused, the court reporter can blank out the screen. It's very simple. You'll take no abuse as a real time writer. If they want to show you a wrong word, great. Thank you, I appreciate that. You can be gracious. You don't need to be a prima donna. You don't need a big ego. Use your judgment. Are they picking on you every 3 minutes? Unacceptable. Let them know. Counsel, this record will get corrected later. Let's move on. That's all. They don't like it? Great. By the way, everything I've talked about so far, from the first session and the second session, I have never had a personal challenge with. I don't get these kinds of comments. I don't get these kinds of challenges. I wonder why. What is your demeanor like? What kind of strength do you show in your work environment? Are you passive, assertive, or effective? No. Are you passive, assertive, or aggressive? We're going to talk about that later. Attorneys want to look good and they want to win their case. Remember that, folks. Three factors to be aware of. Speak to the jury so they can hear and understand what is being said. The attorneys need to know that. They should master the pause. They could even go to Toastmasters. But just to master the pause, I love to tell the attorneys, master the pause. You know, counsel, you have a brilliant mind. Your thinking is faster than the words could come out, so you talk fast. It's understandable. I've heard you. You're a great attorney. But when you practice pausing, you are allowing the jurors or the judge or anyone listening to you to absorb your words. Now, you don't say this. Don't say this. You've got to learn to pause, counsel, because then I'll have 3 or 4 seconds to write the words you just said. That's the truth! Everything is about the attorney and the benefits to the attorney. you practice the pause, you will be more effective. The jury will fall in love with you. Let's go to page 3. They need to speak at an understandable pace. It's shown on the internet and in many empirical places that 140 to 180 words a minute are appropriate for speaking pace. Too fast and too slow does not work. Have you ever had a slow attorney?
Oh.
Oh my God, we had one once and every sentence was so slow. It was much easier to watch paint dry than listen to him. Find a clear balance of confidence, lack of arrogance. For some people it's impossible. Is it possible to talk to an arrogant attorney? That's your decision. That's your deal. I find there are some people who have such an ego. That's it. I'm not out to change them. I'd love to. Okay. But it all starts with the court reporter being competent. When you know in your heart you are a good or great court reporter and you operate from that place, you don't allow anything to taint that. Some reporters handle several people talking in different ways, such as announcing, attorneys, the record is shuffling. You're putting them on notice. Some of them do care. Some don't. And asking whose comments would you like to appear on the record if they're talking on top of each other. If you overlap, sometimes vital information is not recorded on the record. It is not your fault. It is not your job to decide what is vital. It is their job to speak appropriately for the record. As Dom Tursey says, speaking for the record is not conversational speaking. Speaking for the record is a very distinct, clear way of speaking for the record. When two or more people speak, neither one is making a record. Whose turn is it? Pick one. Let them pick one. But do you understand how happy you can be when you say these things? Well, you can have a little bit of fun with this, a little bit of levity. And here's our queen of levity. Will you both stipulate, and I'm going to tell you, if you didn't sign up for Pam's classes, you would now. But you already did, so that's great. Okay. Will you both stipulate that I should paraphrase what you are saying? Otherwise, speak one at a time or call in a new reporter. You see, I have no problem throwing anything away. I start every day with a full tank of gas, and when it runs out, it's on empty. So let's not run it all out before lunchtime. Page 4. The average court reporter writes 300,000 to 500,000 words in a day. It is best for everyone if that does not occur in the first 2 hours. Another couple of little comments. Some reporters handle fast talkers in different ways, such as counsel. I've already said this, but what the heck? If you continue to speed, I'm going to give you a speeding ticket. The 240 words a minute, you are speaking at 340 words a minute. Which 100 words would you like me to omit? If you didn't write it down, it is in your handout in print. Yes, it's a little repetitive. It on purpose will be a little repetitive, the different things I talk about throughout the day. Do you give a lot of thought as to how much the jury or the judge absorbs and understands your spoken word? Can you see how much more effective that is than telling them about you and your hard job? And why it's just too much for you to write so fast. I know I put it in here. I'm sprinkling it in. But you want to make sure you're considering them as well. Does that make sense? One sure way of losing your audience is by talking on top of each other. How about this one? Tell me if this has ever happened to you. I've heard attorneys say to me at the beginning of a proceeding, court reporters think I talk too fast. Has anybody ever heard that one?
Yes.
Yeah. So, most of them interrupt me. Have you ever heard that one?
Yep.
And what happens to you? You get nervous? You get upset? You get on tilt? You get a little squirrely? Get a little worried? I say, so? How dare, I don't say this to them, but I think, how dare you talk to me that way? What are you trying to do? Are you trying to intimidate me without my permission? I don't think so, jerk. No, I don't think so. But you get the idea? Why are they doing this? Sometimes they want to do that to put you on notice that it's okay to interrupt them. If I go too fast, just slow me down. I would never do that. Never. Counsel, you already know you go too fast. There's no reason for me to slow you down. You talk the way you talk. I'll report the way I report. You have an excellent court reporter in front of you. I am in the top 1.5% of quality, top-notch court reporters in the United States. First of all, you're a Texas CSR. Automatically, you're there, okay? If you choose to talk too fast, that's your choice. I don't need to put you on notice. You will get what you will get. You will get what you create. You are not there to be their mommy, daddy. You are not there to help them. You are not there to police them. Figure it out. Guess what, counsel? You're all grown up. You're a professional attorney. Figure it out. Now that's my attitude. I don't say those words, but I just tell them. I absolutely will not interrupt you. You've already told me. Now, are you ready for my next statement? We're going to start the deposition or the court trial or whatever. Anita, would you swear in the witness? Sure. I am Anita I am Anita Johnston. I am the official court reporter in these proceedings. Mr. Barzalski walked up to me before the proceedings and announced to me that he speaks very fast and that court reporters interrupt him so he could slow down. I have advised him and everyone here in the room, I will never interrupt these proceedings if it's related to Mr. Barzalski speaking too fast. If anyone has a problem with that, please speak up now. Pause. Would you raise your right hand? I swear in the witness. That record is made on the record. Usually the attorneys turn beet red. Why would you turn beet red? You told me what you did earlier and I'm putting it on the record so that everybody is advised. That's all. I'm protecting myself. No biggie. Then when he's asking his questions and he's going all fast, dashes. Dashes. So this is what I do. This is just my opinion. You might disagree. I find it very stressful to have to go beyond that. I like to make a record, and I like to have a happy day at the end. I will not have a happy day if I'm interrupting Mr. Motorbound 14 times a day. That does not make me happy. Now, if whatever you're doing doesn't make me happy, I don't do it. Questions?
Now, when you put the dashes, do you have an audio recording and you go back?
I could care less. I could care less. I do not go back to an audio recording that is recording inappropriate talk. I know we want to be perfect. I know we want every word. If I miss one word, absolutely I will go back. Honey, it's using your judgment. I'm not such a prima donna that I will never use it, and especially with audio sync. But if I'm hearing, now after the accident, when you saw the people in the record, and then they came over, what type of the paramedic room is it? Dashes. I will not fight that. How many times do you replay an audio 6 times? No. No, thank you. They don't like it? Great. I'm the live court reporter. Oh, since we're on audio, let's deviate from the handout for a minute. How about the attorney who says, don't worry about it, you'll get it on the audio later. You ever get that?
Yeah.
All right, now you didn't get that, James. But most of them do. Oh, I see, so you expect me to go back and take my time to listen to the audio because I could not hear it clearly the first time. It might not be recorded clearly on the audio, and I am supposed to sweat it, worry about it, replay, and try to decipher this transcript that is not normally an appropriate transcript to put together. Did I get that right, counsel? Well, everybody else listens to the audio. Great! I've got a marvelous idea. Go call everybody else, and I'm going to go to the beach and have buttered popcorn. Do you understand what I'm saying here? How dare you tell me how to do my business? How about this? Oh, did you want audio? I misunderstood. I thought you wanted a live court reporter. Silly me. I'll be glad to leave, and you can call in DAR or FDR, whoever you folks use. Absolutely. Call them. I'm sure they'll do a great job for you. Maybe. And then I walk out. You want me to use my backup audio? How dare you? How dare you tell me how to do my job? Would you like me to tell you how you do your job, sir? Ma'am? How dare you? That's what goes on in my mind. I don't say those words. I do my best to be polite. I do my best to be respectful. And I also do my best to do what's right for me. And I clearly explain, it is not how I do business. That is not what a live court reporter is about. And the live court, I've known some live court reporters who have relied on their audio. It didn't come through because they didn't hear it live. They didn't hear it on the recording. So that's what I say if they ever give me that kind of a comment. I absolutely refuse to acknowledge that. That's not my job. And if you want me, you'll have a great court reporter, you'll get me. If you want somebody else, please go find somebody else. We know that there are so few of us out there who are wonderful. I'm not trying to brag, I'm stating a fact. Does this make sense? And I'm so happy I get to say it to Texas CSRs here, but I'm also saying it to you folks on the video. We have people on these audio CEU videos who are absolutely wonderful reporters. And it's not about their labels and it's not about their credentials. It's about who they are as people and how they are growing. And thank you for being here on these seminars because you are growing and that really pleases me. So in no way am I saying anything less to you wonderful folks. Okay. So let's go back to our handout. Are we good with the attorneys who walk up to us and say, reporters tell me I talk too fast? We're pretty good with that one? Well, you do.
Yeah.
But you don't need to be put in that role. And you can practice or rehearse or come up with sentences that feel right to you. I'm only sharing with you what comes to me and what feels right with me. My words aren't perfect. My words aren't necessarily the best. You might have a better answer or a phrase. Hey, where do you think I got that phrase from? I write 250, you talk 350. Which 100 words would I look for now? I got that from one of my students. Isn't that great? I love it. Okay. Let's go on to page 5. We are going until 12 noon. It is now 11:13. Would anyone like a stretch break?
Yes.
I would.
All right. I'm going to tell you that you get exactly a 1.5 to 2 minute stretch break. And the reason is Jeff is going to be mad at me already, but we're on a 2-hour time frame with the video. For that reason, I'm serious. 1.5 to 2 minute stretch break. Either run and back or stretch. You see how well prepared I am. You see how well prepared I am. It's called Thank You, Jeff.
Bless you for letting us get up.
I know it's a little tricky.
Yes, if we buy that here,
Just because you're there doesn't mean that she's a hand. What's her hand?
She's glad I got here for the children's camp one.
What's his name's daughter's
name?
Bryce. Somebody Bryce. He's good. Why am I coming?
I don't know.
You look like but
are you talking about? Are you talking about the director?
Ron Howard. His daughter is.
She's an actress.
Somebody Bryce.
Wow, that's
Would that say her last name was? Yes. Yeah, my brain is going, that's why I'm and then the other one is Jessica Chastain. It just takes me a minute to get there.
Thank you.
And isn't she part of that clan?
Yeah.
It's so beautiful.
Y'all are flattering me.
And long red hair.
I got 4 hours of sleep on it.
Oh my God. And they both have long black, long red hair. Well, I've been teaching them well.
Is that natural?
This is the box. This is the little box.
Really, it looks good.
Really? Well, it should because it blends perfectly.
It looks good. I like the color, yeah.
I've done it since I was 17.
Oh, wow.
I think it's probably staying.
Wow. That's fun.
Well, I'm looking forward to this.
And tell me your name one more time.
Tabitha.
Wonderful.
I'll crush you again. I'll be coming to your
room. She's a
doll. It's time, people!
I'm going. Okay, because you all chose not to be back on time, there will be no more stretch breaks. You're not here. You said that was okay. So let's go down. We are on page 5. So we're saying, she's nicer than I am. This is where your confidence kicks in. You control your life. Remember how Sylvia handled her problem. Common sense mandates that if the attorney is aware that they talk too fast, do something about it. Unless they don't care, that their message won't be comprehended. It places incredible stress and transcript prep time for the court reporter. Well, it can. It's not going to place incredible stress on me. Okay. Court reporters should put that on the record at the beginning. They take care of it early and then eliminate the stress. And I told you about that, how Mr. Borzowski walked up to me and said, everybody says I talk too fast. Other than the obvious, practice slowing down, I can recommend 3 things an attorney can do. I've already mentioned 2 of them. One is work with a speech coach. Yes, attorneys can hire a speech coach. Yes, attorneys do hire a speech coach. Yes, speech coaches can be expensive. Or are they? If you're a young attorney and you're starting out a career and you're going to invest in a speech coach and learn skills and techniques for life, how expensive is that? In my opinion, it's 0. It's nothing. For you to develop phenomenal skills, presentation skills, I'm active in the National Speakers Association. We have many attorneys who belong to that association. They have mastered their skills throughout the years. Their presentation skills are fabulous. Guess who doesn't like them? Their opponent. Who wants their opponent to be better than them? Just food for thought. I have a dear friend in Vegas. She is a speech coach. She used to be an attorney speech coach until they couldn't afford her anymore. They chose not to pay her fee anymore, which was so high she didn't want to do it anymore. She was normally entry level, $5,000 a day. When she became $50,000 a day, they found someone else. Good for them. Go anywhere you want. It's all good. Secondly, on page 6, we talk about the pause button. I've already talked about it. And number 3, join Toastmasters. I've talked about Toastmasters. It is practically free. Learning to speak serves everybody. I know I mentioned it earlier, but if you have nervousness speaking in front of a group, if you need to create a presentation, you go to Toastmasters. You might make a new friend. You might have a lot of fun. It's an hour and a half meeting. It's right near your house. There are many, many, many to choose from. and you might connect with somebody, and you might be able to improve your speaking skills. If you're called upon to give a presentation, you could practice it in front of the group. If you're going for a job interview, you could practice it in front of a group. If you're coaching your child on giving a presentation, you can go in front of a group. Sitting in the back of the room just listening, it's fun. It is good. And isn't it a wonderful thing to help you out of your discomfort zone or your fear zone when you have a strategy? I hate public speaking so much, I never want to do it. Well, aren't you just hotsy-totsy? Aren't you just the greatest person in the world? You don't like public speaking. Hooray. Guess what? My old self-talk? A lot of negative, trust me. I was the queen of low self-esteem. One of my famous lines was, I am not a computer techie. I am not computer intuitive. I hate computers. Isn't that wonderful? How hotsy-totsy is that? How marvelous does that make me? I'm not good at computers. Well, guess what, Anita? Figure it out. Get good at computers. How can we survive today? All except, it is James, is that right? Good. I mean, James has figured it out, just like my husband. My husband's 85, by the way. My sweetie. He's my honey. Some of you have met him. I learned that changing my self-talk has been huge. When you change your self-talk, you're giving your subconscious new information and new value. I did change my self-talk. What I say now is, becoming a computer tech or becoming computer intuitive requires you to learn one thing. Every time I go to the computer store, buy a computer, go to the repairman, have something fixed, they teach me one thing. I can do that. Write it down in a book. Then I go back. Another thing. And through the years, I've changed my self-talk, I've changed my knowledge base, and I'm a little better. You want to hear how smart I am? and by the way, this is October 2016. I have figured out a way to keep all of my Windows 7 computers. Now, is that pretty good or what? Okay, but you see, we can learn little things, and what we do is we call them bite-sized pieces. How do you eat an elephant? The Indians have that pretty well mastered, don't they? How do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. I think the English language and real time and all that we do in our court reporting is so huge and overwhelming. I think it's like eating two elephants. How do you eat two elephants? Exact same answer. One bite at a time. How do we do anything? Folks, do you see every time you break something down to a very, very small increment, it is doable. It doesn't need to make you feel, well, it doesn't, you allow it, but stressed out. Are you with me on that? So, if you have to tackle something, or you get to tackle something, or it's time for you to grow into something, for example, eliminate or greatly reduce fear, you can do that, and I believe it's in your handout. I have something wonderful in your handout to reduce fear. Oh, I have great answers for you, by the way. So, folks, one bite at a time, new self-talk, these are two doable things. They work, they're wonderful. And I want to tell you, I've been using these techniques with memorizing names. My old self-talk, I'm so bad with names. I don't remember faces well. Some people say, I remember faces. I always know a face, but I don't remember names. And isn't it wonderful to change that conversation? Please look at what you say. Call people on it lovingly. anyone in this room, if you're having lunch with somebody in this room and you hear some negative self-talk, call them on it, because we're not aware. As we know, we've heard the same negative comments so many times by some people. And I myself am right there with you. I catch myself saying, I'm sorry. I say it less. But I'm not just this little machine that says, excuse me, I will never tell you I'm sorry. And by the way, if you've done something wrong and you're genuinely heartfelt feeling that you made a bad mistake, you thought about it, and you do want to apologize, I'm sorry is perfect. I'm not telling you never use that phrase. You want to be polite when appropriate. I've watched waitresses in restaurants. My husband needed the salt, and he's an old army guy. He's kind of a roughy gruffy, and I always try to teach him to be sweet. Well, he's very sweet. Anyway, he says, I need salt. Okay. A server walks by. Get me the salt. Say, please. Please. He says, they don't say please in the army about face. Please. We're not in the army. She brings the salt and says, I'm sorry. Here you are, sir. She wasn't even our waitstaff. She was a lady walking by. But what is her common parlance? I'm sorry. So, do you get the idea here? So, I know, you've said it a lot before. But thank you for being patient with me. Okay, let's continue on. We are now at the bottom of page 6. Drunk driver jury trial. I love it when you read, in all my classes I have people read, but because we're on mic and I just have to repeat it, I will read. Okay, did yours get a little goofy there in the corner? In a drunk driving jury trial, the police officer testified as to what he said when he gave his field sobriety tests to the defendant. He spoke so fast on the witness stand that it was very difficult for the jury to understand what he said. The reporter had a very difficult time writing what the officer said. Ultimately, the jury found the defendant not guilty. They concluded that the defendant probably could not understand the officer's directions because he spoke too fast. So I say to you, how many police officers have been trained to give field sobriety tests appropriately? Again, it's an awareness. It's not a big deal. But they could have a 30-minute training, maybe two times a day, or two times, or three times. Maybe an hour training. Maybe they could practice, see what it's like. And can you imagine the quality of the field sobriety training out in the field when an officer has been appropriately trained? So, taking a look at our history, look at all this. Okay, fast-thinking attorneys speak fast. Wise attorneys slow down. Bottom line, speak one at a time. Speak in sentences, don't grunt. Use real words, pace yourself. When I use the phrase bottom line, what do I mean by that? This is information you give to attorneys when you are in conversation with them. If you are communicating on the side or in a visit with an attorney and you want to convey these three items, these are interesting things for you to say to attorneys to help them. Okay, let's talk for a couple of minutes about how you communicate with attorneys. I think it's a great idea, if you are able, to talk to an attorney off the record, during a break, during a lunch hour, before the session, whenever it's convenient, and whenever you both have time. You could say things something like, okay, you could say something like, counsel, when you speak for the record, you are doing a wonderful presentation to represent your client. When you speak in your normal parlance, if you speak too fast, words get escaped. I love to start my conversations with, I've seen you around a lot, or I've known you for a long time, or we've worked together before, or something. So I just have to tell you, I think you're a great attorney. You do a fine job. People love to be complimented. People want to be acknowledged. People love to be recognized. People want to be respected. Do you know the four things I just said are the four reasons people go to work more than the paycheck? Some people find that hard to believe. It is documented, it is empirical experience, and it is proven from experimentation in universities. People go to work with those reasons that I just said. Anyway, go back to the attorney. You start by acknowledging when your voice trails, or whatever the attorney does, when you speak too fast, or when you do whatever it is that attorney does, sometimes you're going to lose the jury. And if you look at the jury, and you look in their eyes, you can see it's like, bing, I'm lost. And you want to avoid that. Sometimes repeating things is very important. And by whatever the offense or the lacking or the problem is with the attorney, by very kindly, supportively, and mentioning it, can serve the attorney well. Now, we all know by now what Anita's secret is, don't we? What I'm really, really saying, don't we? My secret is, it's not about the jury. It's not about anybody, it's about us. We want to be able to get a better record. Please help us. That's what we're saying. But we're phrasing it in such a way that it's more appealing to the attorney. Do you follow what I'm saying here? So sometimes communicating can go far. A simple conversation can go far. By the way, I love having conversations with judges. I'll go into chambers and I will first say to the clerk, I'd like to talk to the judge for a few minutes. Is now a good time? You have your little notebook and your notes. And the clerk might call the judge and say, your court reporter wants to see you. Is this a good time? Whatever they say. No, how about coming back at 3 o'clock? Sure. You walk in and you go into chambers and you have a little chat with the judge. What do you talk about? What's bothering you? What would you like to see change? Remember, you are self-empowered. You are in control of your life. Your judge doesn't give you lunch till 3 o'clock. Unacceptable for you. Etc. Whatever the problem is, you can have a conversation. I worked in the Los Angeles Municipal and Superior Court. We had 105 municipal judges. I had respect for 5 of them. Do you know what that meant? It meant I had zero respect for 100 of the judges in our courts. I thought they were awful. They made judgments on the way their day was going. I had one judge who I worked with for a long time. It's Wednesday night. It's a jury trial. They're deliberating. Wednesday night. The judge did not let them go until 11:15 at night. Thursday was Thanksgiving Day. How many of those jurors had people come in from out of town? How many of those jurors had family plans? How many of those jurors didn't get to go to the market? When you think about the audacity and the nastiness of this man who had no family and didn't care. When I say I had disrespect for 100 jurors, I'm not saying they're all like that, but that's what we lived with. And anyway, then they merged with the Superior Court reporters and became one huge unit. I went up to Superior Court for 2 years, 3 years before I left. And then I became a freelancer and I hung a shingle with my workshops. But it hurt my heart to see what people went through. And he could be very nasty. I don't know if you've heard nasty stories about judges, especially federal court judges. I've heard some doozies. If anybody wants to share one, you're welcome to. Yes.
Oh, I had a situation where we were having a bomb threat, and he was just continuing to hold court, and the sirens are going off. We're having a bomb threat, and they're blaring over the loudspeaker, you know, please exit the building. And he's just up there talking and not stopping.
What did you do?
And I didn't handle it good. Okay, I've learned.
What did you
but do? But I didn't do good. At the time, I was thinking, what is he doing? You know, I'm wanting to leave now, okay? And he just keeps talking. And so I just kept sitting there. And then finally, some of the other people were like, you know, we need to go. And then, you know, the bailiff was coming in there saying, you know, she was getting in trouble because we weren't leaving. The sheriff's department, you know, she worked for the sheriff's department. She was like, we need to, you know, vacate the building. And he just kept going. And
did you all hear that? Let me repeat it for the record. Your name is?
Sherry.
Sherry. Oh, it's still Sherry. I asked you earlier, right? She hasn't changed her name. Okay. Sherry was in court. There was a bomb threat. The judge kept going. And she didn't know what to do. And it was very tense. And everybody was staying in the courtroom, continuing the proceedings as the judge directed. Then the sheriffs came in and said, everybody needs to evacuate now. And finally got the ball rolling. And eventually Sherry left. Sherry said she did not handle it well. And I say, I don't know. Of course, I think Sherry values her life more than the judge values your life.
Correct.
So that's one thing. But we never know 100%. And I think what you did was to try to be as respectful to the judge and the court. I think you really did your best. And sometimes there is other best we can do. Today you would walk out.
Yeah, yes.
And I did once when I was in a
job. I'm more like you now, but back then I
okay, but you know, we can't beat ourselves up. We are doing our best. Do we care? Are we wonderful people and dedicated to our jobs? Oh my gosh, you can't get better than that.
Yeah.
And Sherry, I'm glad you're alive. I'm glad it worked out well. And what can I say? I'm not saying you were terrible or wrong or whatever. Your husband would, but but anyway, it was an interesting story.
Wow. Yeah.
Anybody else? Anybody else have a story that was with a goofy one? I probably have one that would top everybody's. They don't want to hear my story.
I do.
Yeah, I do.
Do you know I've never told it? Isn't that amazing? With all the talking that I do. There was a juror in federal court. The federal court judge was doing whatever he was doing with either testimony or jury charge or whatever. And the juror raised his hand after a long time. Said, I have to go to the bathroom. The judge said, no, we're not taking a break yet. And sometimes judges do that. And he said, about 2 minutes later, excuse me, I have to go to the bathroom now. And the judge said, no, we'll take a break in a little while. The juror pulled his pants down and peed in the court. What choice do you have? I guess for whatever reason, there was no room to walk out. I personally would have tried to walk out. But Anyway, sometimes they are unreasonable. I told you I've never told that story before. Don't tell anybody.
Did he go to jail? What happened to him?
Was he escorted?
No, he did not go to jail. I think there actually was a hearing and he was found totally fine. I mean,
he had to go.
Yeah, when you gotta go, you gotta go. But honest to God, when I tell you there are some unreasonable judges out there.
Yeah.
Okay.
Unreasonable attorneys, too.
I was going to tell you something. What was I going to say? Would you get that? Okay. So, you've talked about the judges. We've talked about the attorneys. No. Is that today? Right now?
No.
No.
You said
no.
You were going to talk about it.
Later.
Okay.
In its place.
Okay.
Okay. And they don't have a handle. But thank you. That was an excellent idea. Excellent. Thank you. Okay. So, attorneys can be very strange. I know what it was. I'm going to go in and have a little chat with the judge. And I want the judge to know me well. Let's say I'm walking in for a day or a few days or a week. And I say, Judge, I'd like to ask you a few questions.
All right.
When I need to interrupt, for example, if people are talking on top of each other or they're talking too softly or I can't hear for the record, would you prefer that I address you and I go through you for you to admonish the parties? Or would you prefer that I handle it and talk directly to the parties? You see, there are several types of judges. Some judges are relaxed. You handle it, I'm fine. They just want to kind of enjoy their day. There are other judges who are very, very exacting. And technically, the law says you address the judge and let the judge address the party. You are asking them their preference. By this question, you are saying, I respect you, I give you power, I want to please you, I want the courtroom to be run your way. Do you see what I'm saying? So you're giving that message. Also, you are letting the judge know that you will interrupt. You know how some people say, don't ever interrupt, don't ever interrupt. When the judge says it, sometimes people are not comfortable saying, His Honor or Her Honor would never like me to interrupt these proceedings if I don't hear clearly or whatever. It's awkward. This way, you're bringing it out in the open, behind the scenes. If the judge never wants you to interrupt, you're discussing it in chambers. And then I would say something like, Then, Your Honor, because you don't want me to ever interrupt and I could have challenges with the record, it is my practice to put this on the record and make sure that the record is clear, that there will be no interruptions when the record is not accurate. Are you okay with that? Now, if they say no, then let's discuss it, because we have a problem. You are going to protect yourself. To the judge is not Almighty God. Get this word judge out of your mind and say, let's figure it out, because you have your standards, your morals, and your procedures. And nobody's going to violate those. What do you suggest I do instead? Just let it go. Don't worry about it. That's a marvelous idea. Remember, we acknowledge first. Great idea, Judge. I don't have to acknowledge. I don't have to address it. And now my record is compromised. And if anything pertinent or urgent is said in the moments that I'm not reporting, as an official in this courtroom and an officer of the court, I could be held liable for not making a clear record. So, in order to protect my liability and to totally respect you, let's think about an approach to this. Do you see what I'm saying? We're going to take care of ourselves. We can do it kindly, not rudely. And I've never had a judge say that to me, by the way. But it has helped, yes.
I was just gonna comment that this is valuable information because I did not understand all this. You know, I started court reporting when I was 19 years old, and I was a people pleaser, and I wanted to do it perfect, and I cannot say anything, and I cannot rock the boat, and so this was my mentality for 20-something years, and pretty much led to a nervous breakdown, you know, over it all, and it was ridiculous. Yeah. And I was an official for 7 years, and the judge I had, I should have known, you know, like 2 days in, he's like, you know, I would appreciate it if you wouldn't interrupt. And I'm thinking, okay, what? But I did not address it. So I never did, because I didn't know how. I didn't know what to say. And so it was just a nightmare pretty much the whole time.
Did you all hear that?
Over, you know.
I need to let the record know what you said. That was huge. Absolutely huge. I wish I could take your words in your brain and your thoughts and interject them in a little shot to every court reporter in America. Yeah. What you said was brilliant. She never interrupted. She didn't know how to interrupt. And for 22 years, she was quiet. She did not know how to handle problems. It led to a nervous breakdown. Folks, this is exactly what I'm talking about. We must find our personal power. We must find our voice and our importance. And I want to tell you, I told you the Sylvia story. Nobody messed with her. Nobody told her she was a nothing. Nobody wanted to fire her. She was a fabulous court reporter. People said, you know, she's a great court reporter. She knows how to run a courtroom. Or she's a great court reporter. She knows how to run a deposition. She doesn't let any of this nonsense go by. People loved it. So it took you 22 years and a nervous breakdown to figure it out.
Yeah.
That's a huge price to pay.
Yeah.
And thank you for telling us. See, I wish we had this information and knowledge in the olden days.
Uh-huh.
Even today, I teach today, and people have so many fears, and people don't know how to interrupt. That's why I introduced the idea of 3 times maximum. Because then we're not totally obnoxious, just a little interfering here, working on our record. And thank you for telling us about that. That was huge.
Yeah.
I wish everybody would get this audio. I think Jeff has a piece of gold here that people need to hear. Thank you. Sherry. Now, you haven't changed it since the last time. All right. Are there any other comments or questions or anything that comes to mind? Let me tell you about my friend Marcy. Marcy Bain. We were in L.A. Municipal Court together. 1976. I started October 1970. Exactly 40 years ago. Whoa. Hey. Cool, huh? Okay, so then, as I said, I moved on in later years, and Marcy was still in court. She came to one of my workshops, even though she's a brilliant real-time writer. Thank you, Marcy. And she told a story about a new judge coming to town. Now, in the L.A. Superior Municipal Court, and this is going to the, I believe, the late 90s, late 1997, 98, possibly the early 2000s. It could be 2003, 2004, that time frame. Of course, by then, JAV, which is video, and what do you call it, audio, and others came into the courts. Marcy was one of the senior reporters, maybe number two, something like that. They interviewed 5 live court reporters by the new judge. The new judge wanted a real court reporter. The new judge did not like the electronic recording. Okay, fine. So Marcy set up an appointment. Marcy brought with her 35 questions. She wanted to interview the judge. When was the last time you interviewed the judge who you might choose to work with? Is that a little ballsy? She was like number two on the list. She made her appointment. She actually called the clerk. She said, I'd like to have time with the judge to ask him questions. How's 9 o'clock Thursday morning? And the clerk looked it up, confirmed with the judge, and said, that'll be fine. She came in Thursday, 9 o'clock in the morning, with her list of questions. She asked all kinds of things. What are your starting hours? What are your ending hours? What is your policy on breaks? What is your policy on lunch hours? What is your policy on readbacks? What is your policy on this, 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 this? 35 questions. The judge answered them. She ended up getting the job. She liked the judge and obviously liked his answers. If he said, I like to work through lunch sometime, that would be unacceptable for her. Not for everybody. If you have environments where you need to work through whatever the word through means, maybe you've got snacks with you. You'll always take a 5-minute break. You will take care of your bodily needs and whatever is your essentials without a question. And maybe you bring trail mix, fruit, something like that. You have access to coffee. Whatever your choice, you know my choice of treat by now. Right? Buttered popcorn. I don't drink. Okay. So anyway, Marcy asked the questions, he answered them, and I don't know the details, but he did hire her. And she was very happy working for him. Why don't we do that? I agree, she's been there, what, over 30 years. She has all that life experience under her. I agree, that would certainly be different from your situation. And how do you teach life experience? You know, I've been looking for the answer to that one for a long time. James, have you figured it out? No. That is the $64 billion question. You can't. However, remember what I said earlier? Surround yourself with smart people. Do you have access to good people? And I just want to go back to that comment for 1 minute. Mom. When your mom is a quote-unquote nag, or let's call it an irritant, doesn't understand, etc. By the way, if anybody doesn't understand anything, if the attorney doesn't understand real time, if mom doesn't understand your schedule, whose fault is it? What?
Mine.
Absolutely. Okay. It is, could you please pass out those two door prizes?
I already did.
Oh, thank you. It's our fault, it's our responsibility. If attorneys don't understand what real time is, what are we doing to not communicate clearly? And in my workshops, I actually have several pages on this topic, what to tell attorneys. Let them fill out a form, initial it, sign it, proving they do understand what is going on. So it is our responsibility. I believe we must take responsibility. And that's just it. So that's how I feel. So what we were talking about, which was, tell me what we were talking about. Excuse me. You're much younger than I am, and I'm allowed to forget. I've earned the right to forget. When I have a forgettery happening, it's okay. You're too young. I'm just playing. Okay, but I really was talking about Marcy and communicating with the attorneys and doing whatever works well for you. See, I found, I always used to say you must have a lunch hour or whatever. I'm a foodie, what can I say? But I've learned some court reporters do fine without a lunch hour. If they say, do you want to work through lunch? Of course, you know what they do. They say, do you want to work through lunch, Mr. Attorney? Yes. Do you want to work through lunch, Mrs. Attorney? Yes. Do you want to work through lunch, Mr. Paralegal? Yes. Do you want to work through lunch, Mrs. Witness? Yes. Great, I will too. So let's just order in and we'll go forward. Court reporters get upset. Oh, give it a rest. Folks, come on. Don't take it so personally. Let them be. They're going to ignore you. You are a little nothing. And you're not getting your self-esteem and joy and recognition and accolades from that room. So let it be. What I like to do is, I like to say, by the way, council, I am happy to work through lunch as long as it's till 1 o'clock. Anything after 1 o'clock, we'll get a lunch break. That's what I say. Oh, okay, yes.
Oh, I was just going to say, you know, from the beginning of me taking that court job, you know, I didn't understand all these things that I've learned now, but so from the very beginning, I was just always about pleasing, whatever he wanted,
yes.
I'm going to do it. If
you yes.
take a break, I'm running down the hall to the bathroom and running back.
Yes.
Okay, I'm ready, you know, instead of saying, okay, I need to take a break. And so I did not set, you know, how
it's I all right.
the parameters, and then I, you know, just continued to
have all that stress when you've got to go to the bathroom,
yeah,
and you're 20 minutes late. Now, what is that doing to your body? Horrible.
Yeah.
Okay, so I would say as long as it's by 1 o'clock. Oh, I only have a few more questions. Gee, we've never heard that, have we? So now a few more questions. It's now 1 o'clock. So tell us, Mrs. Jasper, why did you go to that store at 8:30 in the morning? We'll be taking lunch. Would you like 45 minutes or an hour? Now, between you and me, 20 minutes is fine. It's not that I'm a prima donna, but under promise, over deliver. Would you like 45 minutes or an hour? I've only got a couple more questions. We'll keep going. No, it is after 1 o'clock. And as far as I'm concerned, we made an agreement. That's it. That's it. I do not get abused. Now that's mean. Some reporters say that's okay.
Yeah.
Just give me 5 minutes for my trail mix. And they're fine with that. Great. If you want 5 minutes for trail mix, take 5 minutes for trail mix. Do you know how many court reporters go home with splitting headaches? And that is ridiculous. My friend Donna in Florida said online, she says, oh, I just tell them I have hypoglycemia. And I don't. And are you a human being? Do you still need to go home with a splitting headache? Do you need to do that to your body? I don't do excuses like that. And sir, if you don't understand what a lunch hour is or what a bathroom break is or what a breather is, you need to go back to life school. Truly. This is silly. Absolutely silly. It's called a break. Sometimes you need a break.
Yeah.
You don't function well without a break.
That's an American problem.
Does this all make sense, folks?
It's true.
Okay. So I've got something to share with you in the next 2 hours. It's my favorite book. I've alluded to it. I've shared with you thoughts from the book. And I'm not going to tell you the name yet because you're all here this afternoon. But it's a book that really, I think, nails home a lot of what we've talked about this morning. It is not about a book on attorneys. It is not about a book on court reporting. It is not about a book on real time. It is a book on one of my most favorite subjects. So, tune in. We are at the end of our 2 hour session here, and we, live here, we're going to enjoy a nice lunch. Maybe you will too. But whenever you're ready for your third session or your next session, wonderful. Thank you all very, very much.
Well, there you go. You're done. How easy was that, huh? Hope you had a great time taking this program. Now you have a few more CEUs to add to your CEU bucket there. Now remember, if you're taking one of our longer courses, please wait until you finish all the seminars before you send us your answers. And please try to, if you're going to put them in an email, copy them in one straight vertical line separated by the different course titles. And that makes it easy for me to grade, makes it go a lot faster, and I don't make any mistakes. Well, not so many. Okay. And also, you can scan them in order and send them to me as well. Remember, we are always putting new content up here. Every year, we will have at least 4 to 10 more hours worth of CEUs that you can get here from the comfort of your home. So if you know more court reporters that would like to get their credits that way, please let them know about it. And remember, you're home for CEUs online, Jeff Justice Seminars, where you can get your CEUs online anytime.